There we go. And I hope you remember that Leslie Steed has got recordings of the previous sessions. If there was anything you missed in the lightning quick nature of the contents presentation. So last week we looked at intercession, if you remember. And I think the homework was to consider how you might follow Agnes Sanford's advice to pray small for 3 days and watch, or to pray briefly before, during, and at the end of a regular activity that you do, and so to make sure that you were doing that activity with Jesus and observing the consequences. Did anybody undertake the homework? And if so, did anybody have anything to report? Nothing to report. So let me get...
Not yet.
Oh, sorry?
Not yet, but we live
not
in
yet,
home.
Maureen. Cherry, were you going to come in? You're on mute, Cherry.
Is that better? Yeah, I had a very difficult conversation that I knew I'd got to have. And I did actually pray hard for 3 days about this conversation, purely about that, you know, that it went well. Mm. I didn't mind what the outcome was, but just that it went well. And actually, yes, prayer was answered because it went incredibly well and the whole conversation wasn't difficult at all. So I pray thankfully that prayer was answered on that occasion on a very small.
Praise be. Praise
yes.
be. So, I mean, last time we were talking about intercession and there were certain things I was trying to get across about what intercession was not, as well as what intercession was. What intercession is not, is it's not magic. It's not a means of manipulation of our God. It's not persuading God to do what God otherwise would not do. It's not trying to get God to break these immovable laws of nature. Neither is it just to get us motivated. We talked about that, how it's not just, although it does change us, it's not just about changing us, but actually it's about positively us cooperating with God in living out of the kingdom, not least in terms of healing. It's one of our best ways of loving people. We should prepare both for things to happen in intercession and for us to be disappointed in intercession. And God's love is consistent either way. That answers come to prayer in different ways, and that we purposefully do not understand actually how intercessory prayer works. This is part of God's mercy towards us, but we are called to do as Jesus did, and that includes intercessory prayer. Pauline and Rod, you've got your yellow hand up. What do you want to say?
I think we've got to be quite careful when we're talking to people about intercessory prayer. I mean, basically, simply, we are often taught that there are three answers. No might be one, yes might be another, and wait might be another. Now, that's to simplify things very much. But I think sometimes praying for small things, yes, we can do that and we should do that, because I think there's nothing that God is not concerned with in our lives. But I think that giving the impression that actually, you know, our prayers are going to be answered, you know, in one particular way can be very off-putting for some people. There might be people who've been ill for a very long time, for instance, for whom we pray and pray and pray. We pray according to God's will, and we know that God does not want people to be sick. Jesus didn't want people to be sick. He healed those who were around. But there must have been some that couldn't reach him either. And what happened to them, I often wonder. So I think we've got to be quite careful how we talk about intercessory prayer and share that with others too. I sometimes find it quite helpful to suggest that we lift people into God's light and we leave them there, not knowing what the answer will be. Because that to me is one way of saying we've got to wait and wait on God for those answers. And sometimes they won't be the answers that we're praying for. Equally so, I remember reading about a missionary in South America, and when somebody was very ill within the area they were working, the local people gathered for prayer and didn't invite the missionary. And the missionary was a bit miffed, I think. And they said, well, we couldn't invite you because you weren't praying for that person to be healed. And we were. And lo and behold, the person was healed. So I think there's a whole dilemma there that we need to think very carefully about. And I did have a quote, which I'm sure you know, Bishop, but I wondered what you feel about it. All is prayer when we have no other object than God's love and the desire of pleasing God, which John Wesley, and I think, I sometimes feel that that's something that is very profound, and yet I suppose some people might think quite simple. I don't know.
I think John Wesley's brilliant. And I think that kind of quote is absolutely on the money for me, Pauline. I think it's interesting you say about raising people into God's light. I think that can be a very powerful way of prayer. And actually, funnily enough, Agnes Sanford, who I was quoting last week, who had remarkable fruit from her praying to the Lord in terms of the healing of people, was always very insistent that when she was praying with somebody, that that they understood that they were facing Jesus, not her. And that actually sometimes she'd put her hand on their shoulder and be behind them so that they could focus on Jesus, not herself, being brought into Jesus' light, not her own light. Mm. So that sense of being, and the important thing about intercession, that actually what we're enabling or what we're seeking to release here is the power and goodness and the light of God into the lives of whoever it is we're lifting up, is really important. And that may mean physical healing. It may actually mean the development of character in a way that prepares us to be reigning in the kingdom of God with our Lord. It may be a whole host of different possibilities.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. Mm. Right. Anything else before we carry on? I mean, of course, what we were talking about last week is not the last word on intercession, which, as you know, is a mystery, but it's a biblical sense of mystery. In other words, mystery not as in the sense of we are totally ignorant, but mystery as used in the Bible, which means mysterion, which means we know certain things in the context of a wider sense of unknowing. So while we know we are called to pray, and that prayer at times seems to be something that is directly fruitful, the wider background is we don't know how it works exactly. Nevertheless, we are called to the posture of hope in our prayer. Shall we move on to our final and fourth prayer and posture? Gillian, you've got your hand up before we do, have you? Or is that my? Oh no, that's my. Sorry, you didn't have your hand up. That was my hand. Right. Well, let's move on. We will, as usual, I'll show you some slides, and then we'll get into groups. Then we'll show some more slides, and we'll have a conversation. So let me share the screen. Share sound, optimize for video clips. Okie dokie. Here we go. Somebody is not muted because I can hear them breathing heavily. So if you could mute yourself, that'd be great. So what we're looking at this week is contemplation as prayer and the posture of attention and certain practices. So as we do so, let's just pray together. And this is the prayer of Advent. Almighty God, give us grace to put away the works of darkness and put on the armour of light. Now in the time of this mortal life, in which your Son, Jesus Christ, came to us in great humility, that on the last day, when he shall come in his glorious majesty to judge the living and the dead, we may rise to life immortal, through him who is alive and reigns with you, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. So start with this picture. You may know it. It's Craigie Aitchison, The Boat, from 1998. Sister Wendy Beckett used it to make the point that the boat doesn't seem to have a sailor, but it sails of its own accord. It is being carried along, and such crew as there are quiet within the boat. The point is, for Sister Wendy, it's a bit like contemplative prayer. Our prayer, our boat. The movement comes from without, from God. We await God. We surrender to God. Where we want to go is not the point, but where God wants to take us. Here, prayer is primarily the work of God, not ourselves. Of course, it needs our consent and our trust. But I begin with this image because it reminds us it is the wind of the Holy Spirit that counts. Jesus, if you like, praying within us, the Father who beckons to us. Not our project. We're not in control. We can't force the issue. Not for us to decide to realize this deepening, but we open ourselves like a sailboat to the wind of the Spirit. And Sister Wendy, when she uses this picture, is talking specifically about the prayer of stillness and silence, of contemplation, as a key way of drawing closer to God. By such stillness and silence, she says, we become more receptive to God's gifting. God creates the heavens and the earth in this instant. In stillness, we open to the very morning of creation to receive the gift of our being here and now, wholly new from the hand of God. Maybe a surge of wonder and gratitude. And we attend to this love that comes to us in the gift of our very being. And this attention, this confidence and receptivity are part of contemplative prayer. And it's not about manufacturing feelings, whether that's of awe or wonder or gratitude, but in this kind of prayer, we're not trying to think of anything but being still before God's presence, pleasing God by turning up and being present. And of course, there are ways in which the silence is obviously helpful. It can create a space where we're not reactive. It can release us from being overwhelmed or confused and resisting a frenzy of problem solving, and ironically thereby create space for solutions to become clear. And as we still down, we become aware of all this stuff going on within. Or consider the Russian writer Archimandrite Tikhon. He writes that it is remarkable but true that if one secludes oneself in prayer and limits oneself in food and sleep and interaction with people while not allowing any idle thoughts to enter the mind nor any passionate feelings to enter the heart, very quickly one discovers a truth. Besides oneself and other people in this world, there is someone else. And this someone else is patiently waiting to see whether we will pay attention to him during our endless race through life. He is simply patiently waiting, because God never forces himself on anyone. But if one continues to pray properly, and here I must stress, properly, in other words, without arrogance and under the supervision of an experienced guide, then before one's spiritual gaze, remarkable phenomena and images begin to appear. Archimandrite Ticknon. Now, contemplative prayer is both very well known and very little understood, engaged with, or practiced. Take this book by William Bloom. It's not a great book, but it has got a really good story in it. He recounts a workshop he led involving 50 Anglican priests, and they were asked when and how they connected with the beauty and the mystery of God. The interesting thing was that in their lists, there was not one mention of prayerful worship, a point that William Bloom flagged up to them. And their responses were poignant and a little defensive. I'm too busy doing my job, said one. In worship, I'm trying to remember who I need to thank in the notices, said another. And I've got to make sure I don't give that parishioner more ammo by messing up, and so on and so on. Preoccupied by, indeed not a little overwhelmed by their work. And William Bloom suggested to these harassed and helpless ministers, they try the following: pause, sink, smile, and yield. Pause, slow down, and be attentive at some point during the worship. Realize the point and the purpose of what you are about, if only briefly. Then sink into your body, sink into your feet, into your shoes, into the good earth. Be present, breathe deeply, and be aware of what is around: the music, the seat, the smell of incense, if it's there, whatever. Then smile. Be receptive and loving towards the giftedness of this, here and now. Smile, be hospitable. And finally, yield. Surrender to this time and to God's presence, even if you can't feel it. And he suggested to the priest that they should do that at some point, for instance, during a Eucharistic celebration. Whether that's at the end of the Eucharistic prayer, before the collect, whenever. Pause, sink, smile, and yield. It's sound advice, and anyone who knows a little bit about the contemplative prayer will know it's contemplative basics, but not, obviously, very obvious to these priests. It's also a way in which we learn from the yoke of our Lord, who paused in taking time apart, was remarkably present to people, into sinking into the moment of engagement, smiling in his profound hospitality to others, and eternally yielding to the presence of his Father. Pause, sink, smile, and yield. Now, there are two contemplative practices of fundamental importance in the Christian tradition that we need to cover. First, the practice of stillness, or which is called contemplation and sometimes called meditation. And secondly, the practice of watchfulness or awareness. And these practices are not imports from other exotic religions, as is often imagined, but they are found at the core of the Christian way, practices which can greatly enrich our prayer life. So let's look at them: stillness and watchfulness or awareness. Let's start with stillness. Recall the psalmist's words, "Be still and know that I am God," or "For God alone my soul in silence waits." Many contemplatives note that as we become progressively more still, so the things that obscure God's presence fall away, and we become more aware of the God who, in fact, is not absent for us, but who we are looking round, past, over, under in our busyness. Of course, the challenge here is to become still, and the various ways in which we can be helped to become still, including the posture of our body, the use of a prayer word, such as Jesus, lovingly recited to calm our chattering minds. Breathing combined with a prayer word. And perhaps most importantly, a willingness to apply all of this regularly in a disciplined way in daily life. Formal times of stillness are essential, practitioners tell us, but so are opportune moments, such as at the traffic lights in the car, at the bus stop, before a service, wherever we are waiting, and so on. And one of the joys of contemplation is that it relieves us of having to make it successful. William Temple said, prayer which is mainly preoccupied with a result to be obtained is comparatively powerless to obtain results. One analogy is of a two-year-old resting quietly with grandma. The two-year-old unknowingly offering herself to be loved. And just as the baby's love for granny is drawn out further by granny's love for her, so our own love for God grows as a spontaneous and almost reflex response to God's love for us. The analogy also underlines how this is experiential rather than logical, an intimate sharing, a loving attentiveness to God, what the Canadian psychologist David Benner describes as a wordless, trusting openness to the God who dwells at the center of our being, at the center of our world. Be still and know that I am God. Not just be still, you notice from that quote, but be still and know that I am God. In other words, a stillness which is looking to receive God's presence, an awareness and alertness. Now, all very well, you may say, Mike, but stillness in my life is not straightforward. Indeed not. Many, many things can draw us away from stillness. As long ago as 700 years, the 14th century mystic Walter Hilton said, and forgive the sexism of the language, that beginning to still the mind was like coming home to a nagging wife and a smoking fire. It's hardly attractive. We might prefer to stay in the pub. Coming home to a nagging wife and a smoking fire. All the surface distractions and subconscious anxieties upset and unsettle us, and we can't think of anything but all sorts of things, such as are pictured here. No wonder it is difficult to still ourselves. Nevertheless, Hilton says, as we sit with these things and look above, around, and beyond them, we do find over time that the smoke dissipates, the nagging becomes less and less loud, and on the other side of this, there is a presence and a peace. Of course, it's arguably even more difficult in the 21st century when we have so many screens distracting us constantly. And one of the great enemies of prayer and recollection is the plethora of vivid, alluring images in our minds. And we are constantly adding to this in our daily entertainments. But beyond the obvious distractions of everyday life, there are deeper reasons we resist stillness and silence. A Christian understanding of ourselves is that our deepest form of powerlessness is our powerlessness to exist by our own efforts. We don't have the power to bring ourselves into existence or to keep ourselves in existence. Breath by breath, heartbeat by heartbeat, our reality is given us by God, whose reality is God's self. And this powerlessness to be without God, who is being itself, giving us our being, this is the amazing quality of ourselves as a gift of God. And we are to waken to that being the gift of God in gratitude and love. But the thing is, we tend not to be aware of it. And in our unawareness, what Jesus called blindness and the Buddha called ignorance, we try to prove we do have the power, asserting ourselves, grabbing for ourselves being violent and dismissive of others and self-fixating, none of which securely establishes ourselves, but all of which refuse to acknowledge the God-given gift of ourselves. Contemplation and stillness, if practiced long enough and well enough, bring us to the kind of realization of the ways we compromise or violate the God-given, godly nature of ourselves, and how in silence and prayer we can allow the love of God to infuse itself into our hearts and to begin to heal us from this needless and exhausting self-assertion. It's liberation. The time taken in stillness and silence with God then enables us to carry that presence and awareness into the other 23 hours of the day, with a heightened awareness of God is with us, for us. Another thing it's suggested about contemplation is it tutors our desires. One wit said, contemplation is one insult after another, one insult after another, as the things we desire keep popping into our mind and we realize time and again the trivial, superficial, and banal nature of so much of our desiring. What's more, our desires, of course, shape us. And as Thomas Merton says there, life is shaped by the end you live for. You are made in the image of what you desire. Where the heart is, there your treasure will be also, in Jesus' words. A desire for wealth leads to greed, envy, and dissatisfaction. A desire for power saps compassion, just as a desire for reputation feeds self-preoccupation. And a desire for respect leads to an overinvestment in one's self-image. Every desire of this kind can diminish us and damage our souls. And in contrast, Merton suggests contemplative prayer asks us to sit with these desires rather than acting on them. Notice them, let them go, and begin to reach around, under, and over them to a more profound desire. It's not about doing anything, but as Simone Weil, the French mystic, put it, turning in love towards God and offering attentiveness, a kind of prayerful openness, suspending our thoughts and allowing awareness to develop. Simone Weil argues this kind of attentiveness is far more powerful in transforming us than any exercise of our wills fixating on a desired outcome. And that's because where God is concerned, we can't will the presence of God. We can only allow love to draw us into it. And the posture by which we do so is still quiet attentiveness. And we can't will the important changes we know in the depths of our soul are needed for our wholeness. We can only allow them to be the fruit of living life in the awareness of the presence of perfect love. Hence, for Simone Weil, the massive significance of contemplative practice. So if that's a little bit on stillness, then the second thing was watchfulness. Contemplatives counsel us to meet distractions with a steady, silent gaze which is aware of what arises, but not taken in by it. And of course, when Jesus encountered Satan in the temptations in the desert, he refused, you will notice, to be drawn into long-winded conversation, choosing to quote scripture rather than be lured into constant dialogue and dispute. And the early Christian contemplatives drew from this the importance of not getting caught up in interior dialogues or patterns of obsessive thinking that can spell the ruin of prayer and keep us distracted from God's presence and peace. And in concrete terms, we can see how often we entertain such thinking, for example, in our patterns of complaining and excusing of ourselves. Awareness of such patterns can already spell the beginning of liberation from that which oppresses and enable a deeper stillness and watchfulness, a deeper conforming to Jesus' way. Indeed, I remember being counselled myself by a contemplative who said, notice how in the prayer of silence, how often your thoughts turn to either self-justification or complaint, and begin to drop them, self-justification and complaint. And watchfulness must also be combined with stillness, because when we are open in our awareness and intention, there's a possibility of being misled. It's an act of opening ourselves, after all, stillness. So we need to be watchful, because we're open not just to God, who can transcend us, but also, Paul suggests, to malicious powers, to principalities in the language of Ephesians 6. The early Christians criticized the spectacle of gladiatorial fights and other savage entertainments, not least because such spectacles opened people to principalities and powers that could dominate them. So much so that the early Christians suggested it needed exorcism because of the spectacle's liturgical and metaphysical power. Or in Luke 11, not for nothing did Jesus warn that expelling one unclean spirit can lead to the incoming of many more, and the last state of the person could be worse than the first. So we need to be watchful when we open ourselves in contemplative prayer. And some people are wary of contemplation because of the way it opens us to destructive forces, or perhaps because it seems to smack of other religions and their practices, which are not necessarily Christian in origin or intention. Interesting in this regard is the writer David Frenette. Originally not a Christian, but as a young man tried Hindu and Buddhist forms of meditation and eventually alighted on Zen Buddhist practice. Because Zen didn't require any doctrine to be believed. It focused on immediate experience and alleviating suffering. Sounded good, thought Frenette. He wrote, Zen was the perfect postmodern spirituality for me, a formless path beyond belief. However, it was, ironically for Frenette, a preparation for receiving the gospel. He testifies, and I quote, out of the inner emptiness, there arose a presence breaking into me, over me, through me, drawing me in love into greater freedom and a deeper contact with my humanity. Something caressed me, a nameless ravishing. Have I just come back?
Yes, you have.
We should still be in this screen. Let me go back to sharing the screen. How bizarre. We'll go back. Strange. Am I back sharing the screen?
Yes.
Yeah, how odd. I must have clicked something. I'll carry on. So Frenette found that actually his Buddhist practice led him into Christ's presence and action, God's love and life. So it's not always clear that contemplation and meditation practiced in other religions takes us away, but in Frenette's case, drew him to a presence that was personal and clearly for him, tangibly, that of Jesus. In my Zen practice, my mind was emptied, and into this receptive space came Christ's presence and action, God's love and life. Now, within the Bible, there is an implicit theology of attention and awareness, both of which are strengthened by habits of stillness and watchfulness. Jesus goes off very early in the morning to a solitary place to pray, which is an act of sustained attention. Peter and the disciples hunt him down and interrupt him, trying to distract him with what the crowd wants. Jesus switches his and their attention back to what really matters and says, let us go somewhere else, to the villages, so I can preach there also. That is why I have come. Peter and the others were swept away by a stream of thoughts and feelings prompted by the crowds, perhaps thoughts of greatness and success. Jesus wasn't. Paul teaches us we need to catch some of our thoughts and feelings early. In your anger, do not sin, he says. Paul also talks about how we are stuck in automatic behaviours. I don't understand what I do. For what I want to do, I don't do, but what I hate, I do, in Romans 7. You begin to see from such texts the importance of focusing our attention and being aware of what's going on inside us so it doesn't bubble up into stuff that becomes destructive, not only of our others, but of our own souls and spirits. In terms of watchfulness, Jesus asks us to enter into a process of investigative awareness of what's going on in our hearts and minds. We cannot follow this injunction of Jesus without being watchful about what's going on in our hearts and minds. There is an ever-changing flow of thoughts and feelings within us, for from within, out of people's hearts come evil thoughts, he says in Mark 7:21. Stillness helps us to notice what's going on within, as does watchfulness. And only in the light of the postures of stillness and watchfulness can we avoid being captured by our reactions, such as our hypocritical judgment of our brother or sister. And then again, from a contemplative perspective, one begins to hear some of Jesus' teaching on prayer a little bit differently. Take Matthew 6. Often we just focus on the Lord's Prayer there. But what about the rest of that passage about prayer? If you read carefully, Jesus is telling us plenty else about prayer in this passage. We are to go into our inner room, it says, and shut the door. Now, there was no such room in most small and crowded houses in Jesus' time, especially for the poor who were listening to Jesus, which suggests that the inner room must be a metaphor for the interior relationship of contemplation. Our inner room is a place of solitude and stillness. Jesus says to pray to the Father, to focus on God, at least part of which means emptying oneself of graven images, of idols, free from such images and thoughts, and to do so in secret, in hiddenness, even perhaps to ourselves, so not clinging to experiences or feelings or thoughts. And your Father will see in secret. So God will respond in ways not necessarily of our fathoming and will reward us. We are not told what the reward involves, but presumably it is in part a reward including a deepening union with the Father. As Jesus puts it in John 14:20, on that day you will know that I am in the Father, and you in me, and I in you. Now, of course, we don't know precisely how Jesus prayed. Jesus' teaching, however, we know, is to keep the words brief, don't show off, find yourself a quiet place, go apart, early morning is good, be regular, consistent, and be quite happy to be unavailable to others in being available to the Father. Indeed, over very long periods of Jesus' prayer, there's relatively little reported, e.g. the 40 days in the wilderness. And given the time Jesus spent in the Garden of Gethsemane, the dialogue we have is very short. But from the fragments we do have, it seems pretty much like contemplative prayer fits with Jesus' practice, along with conversational prayer, the prayer of praise and adoration, and of intercession and petition that we've covered in the previous 3 weeks of Advent. Unsurprisingly, given the strand of contemplation in the scriptures and the early church, there has always been a presence of contemplatives within the church. So let me just in a couple of minutes give you a very brief history. It flourished with the desert hermits in the 3rd to 4th century. When these hermits were seen as a threat to the institutional church, they were cloistered into monasteries and convents. And for the greater part of Christian history, these monasteries and convents were the wellspring of contemplative spirituality for the church. They were the spiritual balance to the business and political aspects of parish life. And they've always been a source of spiritual renewal in the church's life. You can see the list just goes on and on. Benedict, Francis, Teresa of Avila, John of the Cross, Henri Nouwen, Sister Joan Chichester, etc., etc. And until medieval times, this kind of prayer was not neglected. But with the Reformation of the 16th century, a negative view of monasteries came to dominate. And given that monasteries were the cradle of contemplation and meditation, such forms of prayer came to be regarded with suspicion. Following the Protestant Reformation, monasteries and convents were seen as obvious signs of the corruption of the Roman Church, and they were used as scapegoats. Unfortunately, there were religious orders that were corrupt and in need of reorganization, but condemning all religious orders rather threw the baby out with the bathwater, and a major source of contemplative spirituality was lost. Of course, it didn't die off entirely, and recent resurgences in the Victorian era and so on. But generally speaking, since the Reformation, it has been a very modest tradition. And these days, across the board, in the Roman Catholic, the Eastern Orthodox, and the Anglican communions, contemplative vocations are few and far between. And of course, it's not only due to the Reformation, it's also due in part to the cloistered life being the antithesis of modern Western culture, as well as, of course, many other cultural trends, such as a loss of belief in the transcendent. But it's also interesting how we've shot ourselves in the foot by some inaccurate translations of the Bible from the Reformation onwards. So, for instance, Maggie Ross writes about this. She's a rather angular hermit herself who has a few bees in her bonnet, but she does write profoundly on prayer. And one of the big bees in her bonnet is translations of scripture. She points out that an anti-contemplative history of translation since the Reformation has been held. And one example of this she gives is the word behold. Behold can be distinguished from seeing. Behold is inward vision. Behold is about recognizing the kingdom within and around. As Jesus puts it in Luke 17, the kingdom of God is not coming with signs to be observed, nor will they say, lo, here it is, or there it is, for behold. In other words, see with the inner eye of contemplative practice, the kingdom of God is among you. Beholding is ungrasping, self-emptying, still and silent, gazing prayerfully and attentively. And staggeringly, in the NRSV, the latest translation, it only occurs 27 times in the Old Testament, not at all in the New Testament. But in the Hebrew and Greek original, it occurs how many times, do you think? 1,300. So modern translations have reduced behold from 1,300 to 27 references. Behold, I am with you always, even to the close of the age. That's what the risen Lord says. In other words, you may not see my physical appearance, but understand with the inner eye of your heart that I am present to you. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Ditto again. Behold the Lamb of God, John 1:36. This is not just human flesh and blood you have before you, but see with the inner eye of your heart what is before you. In the liturgy, we've lost it too. Do you remember the days when we used to say, the priest used to hold up the host and say, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Now we just have the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Why have we lost? Behold. You can see why Maggie would be a little bit annoyed. So, let me stop sharing there. And if I can, I'm going to try and get my cursor onto the other screen. Can I get it on? Can I get it on? How do I get this onto the other screen? I can't see how to do that. Let me... Well, so I've given you quite a lot to look at. So what I'm going to do now is put you into groups for you to discuss what we've said so far and see what you think. So if I can do this, I'm going to have to do it with my hand because my cursor won't put me over there. So let's think about how many... Let's go for 8 groups. So I'll give you 7 or so minutes to have a conversation in your groups about what I've talked about in terms of contemplative prayer or your own practice, perhaps. And then we'll come back and have a conversation. So 7 or 8 minutes. Away you go. There we go. Well, welcome back. Welcome back. anybody want to share any wisdom or a comment or a question or a thought? You're very welcome. Don't be shy. It's your last opportunity. This is Advent 4. Speak now or forever hold your peace.
It was nice being in a larger group this time.
Good.
We were a group of four, and I've only been in groups of two before.
Wow. Intense. Thank you, Chris. Anyone else want to make a comment or ask questions?
Bishop Mike, can I pick up the very last thing you talked about,
yeah,
about the use of the word behold? Because for me, I regarded that, where it comes in the Holy Communion service, as a command to look up to the bread and wine being lifted by the priest.
Yeah. And in fact, it is in the imperative. It occurs in the imperative form over 1300 times. So it's telling us to do something. So you're quite right. So can you imagine a word that tells us over 1300 times in the Bible that's now been reduced to 27?
Yes.
I mean, that is a scandal. Pauline, Rod.
Well, we enjoyed our discussion group very much. Particularly, we were talking at one point about that, you know, enter into your room, etc. And I was reminded of the fact that a Jewish friend of mine gave me a lovely prayer shawl, and I asked him the significance of the prayer shawl, and he mentioned about going into the tent of God's presence. And I just wondered whether, in a way, that was, for some people, the only way they could withdraw to be watchful, etc. I mean, Jesus took himself off to the hillsides and things, and perhaps in the crowded houses in which they lived, and in the synagogues too, the only way you could enter into that watchfulness was to wear your prayer shawl. And then we got into a very interesting discussion about monks and nuns, monks with their cowls sometimes, and I had two Anglican nuns that taught us at Sunday school and things, and they were actually wore very old habits, where their eyes, if they wanted to focus on anything, they had to turn their heads. But when they were praying, their eyes were actually enclosed, as it were, to focus on the cross or whatever it happened to be. And the way the habit was formed was that that was what they were doing. So that was quite an interesting way of looking at things, really.
Yeah, it is interesting. It's interesting as also where you started off there about going into your inner room. I don't know if you know Carlo Caretto, but he was a great 20th century contemplative, and he lived for more than a dozen years in the Sahara as a hermit. He was alone with the Blessed Sacrament, milking a goat for food and translating the Bible into local Bedouin language, and prayed for long hours by himself. But when he went home at the end of this to his native Italy, he said his mother, who had spent the last 30 years as a wife, a mother, and scarcely had a moment to herself in that time, was more contemplative than him. She was more still, more attentive, and more in tune with the divine. And his conclusion was not that being a hermit was bad, but that there was something wonderfully right about the way she was able to enter into the inner room, even in the midst of the domestic monastery, as he put it, that she occupied had been for all that time. And of course, you could think about, if you think about it, what a wonderful training parenting children is. In that sense, you've got to be pretty selfless, you know, It involves a kind of withdrawal from the world and from centres of social life, a growing in empathy and unselfishness, putting our own needs second. You don't need a monastic bell if you've got a child crying every 5 minutes, you know, and so on. So there's something about going into your inner room that we're challenged by, whatever our circumstance. Yeah. Faith, you wanted to come in.
Well, talking about the prayer shawl, I mean, what's the idea that you put your prayer shawl over your head and then other people sort of be, you know, kept away from you? It just reminded me of the Wesley's mother. I believe that, you know, having her large, very large family, she told them that, you know, if they found her sitting in a chair with her apron over her head, that they would leave her alone. She was praying.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Yeah. What did Dallas Willard said? If we don't depart for a while, we will come apart after a while. If we don't depart for a while, we will come apart after a while, which is quite a nice little epigram. Anything else before we move on and just do the last bit? Yeah, Brian.
The sense that the church itself should be doing more to show us how to do and help us to do contemplative prayer. I sort of know in my own life, I drifted away from the church, gosh, 50, 60 years ago, because I was searching for something and the church didn't offer it. And being sort of a child of the 60s and that, there was plenty of stuff coming from the East, which was offering that. And it's only in recent years or last 20 odd years, I've realised that the church does offer that which I was looking for, but it was never shown to me when I was much younger. And I'm not certain that it's shown to people today.
Yeah, and I do think my brief kind of potted history, limited as it was, gives a kind of like a potted explanation of that. The suppression of actually some of the riches of the contemplative tradition, which is why I think the popularity of the Eastern religions came to the fore in the 20th century in the way that it did. And actually some of the great pioneers rediscovering Christian meditation and contemplation, like John Mayne and Thomas Merton and the such like, they had a really difficult time with their monasteries who were telling them, you know, basically you needed to do compline, not this kind of like sitting in stillness and contemplation. And, you know, holy obedience, they were torn apart by, because they were called to this way of prayer. But at the same time, they were also called to holy obedience to abbots who didn't know, you know, one end of a meditation stool from the other, to be perfectly frank. And it was very tough. And, you know, so I do think there's been, you know, with the World Community of Christian Meditation and other streams, some recovery of it, but we're still kind of like, you know, only in a recovery phase, I think, at the present time. Yeah. Anything else before we move on? Let's move on then to the last bit. Let me share screen again. And here we go. Current slide. So there we are. So the postures we've been considering so far have been joy with praise and adoration, peace with confession and lament, and hope with intercession. So the posture this evening is attentiveness. We are attentive to the fact that while we say we want to trust and surrender to God, we also need to be attentive to the fact that deep down, part of us doesn't trust God for our happiness. Instead, we develop what the contemplative Thomas Keating calls our own programs for happiness, whether that involves junk food, Netflix, football, or any more dubious outlets. And I'm not trying to judge these activities, but contemplative prayer and paying attention helps us to notice what we're seemingly inordinately invested in, that we take to be happiness generators. And more deeply, it can help us to see how invested we are in certain things about ourselves, like our intellect or our artistic nature or being spiritual. And reinforcing that in conversation and relationship and life. Contemplative attention can get to some of this stuff and reveal things to us that perhaps we need to be working on. We also notice perhaps what bothers us most in others, which is often a mirror to ourselves. And it can help us perhaps to be released for a truer self, ourself in Christ. David Benner, who I quoted earlier, says, what you are inviting by following these suggestions of contemplative prayer is the grace of knowing. It's always a gift of God, but you have to turn up and receive and open the gift. And the posture of attentiveness is precisely this turning up. So just quickly, in terms of some practices, one practice is centering prayer, it's called, which Pete Gregg describes simply as show up, shut up, and look up. But it begins centering prayer by thinking of a particular word that you might use, a sacred word such as Jesus or Lord or love or beloved. Choose one word is the suggestion in centering prayer. And then begin by asking the Lord to teach you how to still and quiet your soul. And it will take time and practice. Don't strive or fall into rigorous effort, but simply open ourselves to God. And when we find ourselves distracted, return to the prayer word, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Let yourself be fully aware, as far as you can, of God's love surrounding you. Keep your back straight, whatever you do, because otherwise you will fall asleep. And as you become aware of thoughts coming into your mind or memories or feelings or images, don't fight them, but simply, as soon as you become aware, return to your word, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. And basically, the idea with centering prayer is to do this daily and to extend the practice in terms of time, day by day. So go from 5 minutes to 6 minutes to 7 minutes, building up to what they recommend, which is about 20 minutes, and ending with, say, the Lord's Prayer or something like that. So that's centering prayer. It's subtly different from the prayer that is commended by the World Council of Christian Meditation, which suggests similarly finding a word to repeat. But with the World Council of Christian Meditation, the key difference is you keep saying the word all the way through the prayer time. And I remember a Roman Catholic nun explaining the difference to me. With the World Council of Christian Meditation, it's a bit like you're batting your wings all the time, saying Jesus, 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 Jesus. Whereas in centering prayer, when you find yourself gliding on the spirit, you simply glide and you don't use the word. And then when you find yourself falling again into thoughts and stuff, then you bat your wings as you say your word, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. And neither is better than the other. They're just, you know, very similar practices, which, you know, one of which you may gravitate to rather than the other. And then, of course, from the East, we have the Jesus Prayer, based on the prayer of the publican in Luke's Gospel, who, unlike the Pharisee in the temple, who congratulated himself on his piety, said simply, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. And out of this has come the prayer, Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. And simply to use that as a prayer that you repeat through prayer time, rather than a simple prayer word. And the Eastern Orthodox commend this prayer for a number of different reasons. But for one reason, it's simple. You don't need any special training to start saying it. You can say it immediately. But you do need to say it with love and devotion, whether it's for 5 minutes or 15 minutes. It's simple. Secondly, they commend it because it's complete. It contains the gospel. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. How does it contain the gospel? Well, the Orthodox argue, first it says Lord, so we give Jesus ultimate authority. Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus refers to his human life and Christ to his being of God, so the incarnation is affirmed. And of course, we can only say Jesus is Lord by the power of the Holy Spirit, according to 1 Corinthians 12:3. So that's another part of the gospel. Furthermore, adoration and penitence are affirmed. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of God, that's the adoration. And have mercy on me, a sinner, penitence. And of course, have mercy is a trusting cry to the one who we know does have mercy. So you can see why they argue it has a certain completeness about it. Thirdly, there's a power in the name. Jesus Christ is not some magical word like abracadabra, but in scripture, the name of God is revered and it does have power. For instance, Acts 4:10-12, where Peter says there is only salvation, quotes, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. And Philippians 2:10, which says, at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow. And of course, we know in scripture that the name holds character and personality when it is uttered. And finally, the Orthodox suggest the Jesus prayer reaches the heart, or the idea is certainly for the descent of the mind into the heart, from moving from thinking about God to being with God in a contemplative mood. And the rhythm of saying this prayer can enable that. The Way of a Pilgrim, if you're interested, is a wonderful little book from Russia, which actually looks at how to practice the Jesus prayer. And this is a quote from it. When I pray with my heart, everything around me seemed delightful and marvelous. The trees, the grass, the birds seemed to be telling me that they had existed for man's sake, that they witnessed to the love of God for man, that all things prayed to God and sang his praise. I felt a burning love for Jesus and for all God's creatures. So those are three different ways: centering, World Council of Christian Meditation, and the Jesus Prayer. But in all of this, there is mystery, as I mentioned earlier. Here's Richard Rohr and what he says. My best writings and teachings have not come from thinking, but as Malcolm Gladwell writes in Blink, much more from not thinking. Only then does an idea clarify and deepen for me. Yes, I need to think and study beforehand and afterwards try to formulate my thoughts, but my best teachings by far have come in and through moments of interior silence and the non-thinking of actively giving a sermon or presentation or a moment of counsel. All grace comes precisely from nowhere, from silence and emptiness, if you prefer, which is what makes it grace. It is both you and yet so much greater than you at the same time, which is probably why believers chose both uprushing fountains and downrushing doves as metaphors for this universal and grounding experience of spiritual encounter. And finally, you may ask, what are the fruits of such a way of prayer? Well, one example from a Christian meditation group, a man complained to the priest leading the group, look, I say my prayer word, I sit there and time goes by, I keep doing it morning and night, I know what you say, just keep doing it, and I don't experience any experiences. But surely, sometime, somehow, something has to happen. Or what's the point? And the priest just told him to keep saying the prayer. Anyway, a week later, the man didn't turn up to the prayer session, which was unusual. Only he did turn up at the end of the session, and it was apparent from his face that something had happened to him. He said he had stopped off at a newsagent on the way, and as he was reversing his car out of the newsagent, a youth had dropped his bike behind the car, so his car had hit it. Immediately, three or four youths had gathered and were demanding compensation for the damage done to the bike. And the man said, I was amazed at my response. In the past, I would have flown off the handle. But no, I asked to see the damage. I suggested that if compensation was due, there was a need for insurance to be claimed and that the police would need to attend. The police came along and the issue was sorted out. In the end, without compensation being paid or a row resulting, I was calm throughout and present to those young people. The fruits of contemplation, not seen in some religious high in that case, but in how we are with others around us outside of these times of prayer. So, we've got about 10 minutes, so we'll stay in the big group. Any thoughts or comments or reflection?
I was struck by Liz, who was in my group, and it struck a bit of a chord with me. She was talking about Compline. I think you mentioned Compline in another story, but
In a derogatory fashion. My apologies, Mary.
Yeah, well, no, but we're talking about the fact that again, it's repetitive words that we might actually know off by heart. That help us to kind of keep focused on God and not on our own thoughts or what word's coming next or whatever. And so although it's more than one word, it's a way of that familiar liturgy is can help us center on God.
Yeah. And I think was it week one, I talked a little bit about repetition, and repetition is not to be sniffed at. Or maybe it wasn't. Maybe it was in a different group I talked about repetition. Maybe it was a different thing. But it's very interesting, repetition. We think if we've done something, we've done it, and we need to move on to something else. There's a sort of love of novelty these days, which is problematic, because repetition is actually that which can enable the shaping of our character in a way that novelty never can, especially repetition if we're attentive to it. I mean, Simone Weil, that French mystic I mentioned, said, "There is no way you can fail not to be spiritually transfigured each time you say the Lord's Prayer, if you say it with the due attention it requires." And yet, you know, most of our world would say, "Oh, I've said that a load of times. I can't get anything out of that. It's like squeezing a lemon when I've already squeezed it dry." Not true. Every time we are in a different place spiritually, in a different situation of hospitality or inhospitality, and the possibilities are there. In relation to that, and in a much more kind of like grounded way, do you know what is in a large scale survey of married couples, do you know what the one thing that was found was kind of like indicative of a really strong relationship? Well, let me tell you. It was the repeated exercise of a peck on the cheek in the evening. Needn't even be something that was intentional and lingering, but it was something that was a regular, frequent, repeated action of affection, come what may, whether there were rows or whatever there were, or kind of lukewarmness and the such like. Because by such repeated actions, we were tutoring ourselves about how to be with one another. Yeah. So, you know, repetition, I think, Mary, is really important in the spiritual life, because it actually does shape our characters and personalities. Anything else? Yeah, Penny. You're on your own tonight, Penny.
I am, because I've got COVID, so I can't be with the others.
Oh, crumbs. Well, carry on. You can't get me from there.
Yeah, I'm a lot better, so you're all right.
Oh, good, good. Well, you
Robert's gone down with it now.
Oh, dear. You look absolutely fine, but anyway.
Yeah, I felt fine. I've just had a cold, so, yeah. I think repetition is great and fine, but I do think the trouble is because we've got so familiar, especially with the Lord's Prayer, we say it too quick. And I think, actually, we need to get in our churches that we slow down. You know, when I have to sign the Lord's Prayer, I can't keep up with most of the priests because it's so quick. And I can sign it pretty quick because I'm used to signing it. But we do. We just need to slow down and think about what we're saying in a lot of our liturgies, because the words are beautiful. They've got such depth and meaning. But we rush through it. We need to teach our priests to slow down.
I would agree. And I would say if we took the Lord's Prayer slowly and really chewed on it, it's, as Simone Weil says, transformational. You just think about it. Start with the word our. Oh, that means I have to reframe every person in this Zoom as a fraternal and sororal relocation of you as my brothers and sisters. That's what I'm required to do by the first word of the Lord's Prayer. Father, the creator of the cosmos, the fire in the equations of infinite and phenomenal energy, relates to me as the best of all fathers to a child. This is gobsmacking. Who art in the heavens? In the heavens, that is. So, and the heavens in Hebrew is the air around us, is the sky above us, and is the realm of the angels and the throne of grace. So God is here in the air around me as much as the throne of grace. Now, I haven't got through 10 words yet, but blummin' heck. Blummin' heck. Thank you. Any other comments, questions, thoughts or reflections? Yes, Pat. Can you come off mute? There you go.
Yes, I'm back. There you go. It's just that you made me realise something when you said, you know, the peck on the cheek. Because it, as when I, very often, it's a similar thing. Because if we're rushing about both doing something, but we brush against each other, we give each other a hug every time.
Mm.
And yeah, I hadn't thought of that as a gelling of the, because quite often we're rushing about and not got time for each other.
Yeah. But that's the critical bit, because that's what we do without thinking. When Peter denied Jesus, he didn't think he was going to deny Jesus, but he did what was in his bones. And what was in his bones was, look after myself, flee from this man, because I'm going to be for the chop if I hang around with him. And he didn't think he was going to do that. But Jesus, of course, the master psychologist, knew he was going to do it. But Jesus also knew he would turn again. He did what was in his bones, you know? And what's in our bones is our character. And that's what we've got to really pay attention to and change what's in our bones. So repeated habitual ways of being with one another that are affectionate are critical, because we're actually shaping our characters to do stuff in our bones that is loving as opposed to unloving. So, yeah. We shouldn't be underestimating this stuff. Nicola.
It follows on a little bit from what Penny was saying about the Lord's Prayer. And I find we disobey all the punctuation when we say anything together. And I just wish people would just pause at commas and stop at full stops and give ourselves time to think about the sentence we've just said.
Yeah, yeah. It's interesting. I remember a Sikh gentleman coming to one of our services, and his comment afterwards was, so many words. How do you cope? You know, because there's a lot more space and silence within Sikh services for to ponder and to receive and to consider. And that point about pause, sink, smile and yield from William Bloom, we need, if we are leaders of services, to create some of the opportunity for pausing, sinking, smiling and yielding. So, for instance, the collect, the prayer at the after the Gloria, That's meant to collect our minds and hearts, which is why the rubric says pause or silence before you do it, to actually bring our minds and hearts together in an aligned fashion here. So whatever we do as liturgical leaders, we need to make that space. Yeah, and that space includes commas and full stops, and it also includes the opportunities that we have within services. And that doesn't mean we take kind of like 3 hours over a service, but what it does mean is that we actually have opportunities within the service for some spaciousness. Yeah. I've got a couple of slides more and then we'll conclude. Is that all right? Yeah. Okie dokie. Just to polish you off, as they say. So let's go back. From the current slide. So, yeah, we might be surprised by contemplative prayer. Here's Dorothy Day, who was a great social activist in her time in New York in the 1950s. Look at what she says. If we are surprised, if we are rushed for time, sow time and we will reap time. Go to church and spend a quiet hour in prayer. You will have more time than ever and your work will get done. Sow time with the poor. Sit and listen to them. Give them your time lavishly. Proof of the pudding is in the eating. Now then, homework. Given we've had 4 weeks on four different prayers and four different kinds of posture for drawing near to God, I would follow the advice of Brother Lawrence. Each of us may have unique ways of seeking God's presence. One may sense God best through praise and adoration, another through surrender, another through yearning and emptiness, and still another through gratitude. Let your own spirit's intervention guide you. So consider for yourselves which it is that you need to focus on and how, because it's not about you exhausting yourselves trying to do everything, but how you are being led on now in your walk with our Lord. But a prayer now further to our reflections on contemplation. Heavenly Father, open our hearts to the silent presence of the Spirit of your Son. Lead us into that mysterious silence where your love is revealed to all who call. Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus. Amen. And to conclude, a Christmassy tune, which is also has a certain contemplative feel to it. I think you might recognize it. And a very happy Christmas when it comes, and a remainder of Advent be blessed for you. Good night.
Thank you.
Good night. Thank you.